Welcome back to our study of the Word. And this is where we, pastors here at Redeemer Bible Church, are walking you through the Scriptures chapter at a time. We've entered into the book of Hebrews. And in our study today, we come to chapter 2. Remember, by way of review, the book of Hebrews is helping these young Jewish believers who were raised in Judaism and thus raised under the Old Covenant. And the Old Covenant was basically a promise God made to Abraham, that Abraham's name would be great. It's great. Everybody knows the name Abraham. That he would be the father of a great nation. Yeah, well, they're alive to this day. That God would promise him land, and they were given land, promised land. And then that under and through his seed, all nations, even Gentiles, would be blessed. Well, all those promises actually have been fulfilled. God has fulfilled and completed the first covenant. And even Jeremiah 31 spoke about the fact that there's going to be a new covenant. God's going to ratify a whole new covenant, a new promise, the way we're going to relate to God and God's going to relate to us. It's a whole new age. It's the age of grace. It's the age of the new covenant. So we have the Old Testament, the Old Covenant, 39 books, but now we got 27 books, the completion of the Bible, that's called the New Testament or the New Covenant, because it instructs us, how do we relate to God? Not one that he's the creator and we're the creatures and we try to appease him with sacrifice. But rather, as John the Baptist said when he saw Jesus, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Before that, you had to find an animal, an innocent animal, and have it died. You took that animal to a priest. The priest killed the animal. You know, the only reason the animal was dying was because of your sin. And you grew up knowing the consequences of sin. The wage of sin is death. But then God, that was when sins were covered in the Old Testament. But they were looking forward to one who would come, God's provision, the Messiah. One would come and be the final provision to remove all those sins. That's why John the Baptist said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. All the Old Testament sins had been covered, but now we in the New Covenant, by our faith, owning up to the fact that when I look at the law, I realize I can't keep the law. You got to get in your mind. The Ten Commandments. Do you keep the Ten Commandments because you have to? It will make you a better person, and it's your way to get to heaven? No, that's Old Covenant. New Covenant is we keep the Ten Commandments because Jeremiah 31, 33, God says he's put his law within our heart, the Spirit of God within us, causing us to want to keep the Ten Commandments. So we live out the Ten Commandments, not because we want to be a better person, go to heaven, because we're already declared a child of God, and that's the basic difference. So we don't have priests that we go to that intercedes between us and God. Remember in 1 Timothy 2:15, verse 5, chapter 2, when he says we have only one intercessor between God and man, and that's Jesus Christ. So in an attempt in this book of Hebrews, the writer, which I think still is Apostle Paul, that the writer basically is helping these Jewish believers who grew up under the Old Covenant to basically realize the Old Covenant was to basically introduce you to Jesus Christ so that you could live under the New Covenant. That's why in Galatians 4, Paul says the law was a tutor to bring us to the point that we realize God is holy and I'm not. And I'm never going to be able to keep the law all the time. There's something wrong with me. And that's when I realize I'm in a hole and I'm not going to crawl out of this by good works and sacrifices and trying to be a better person. I need mercy. I need grace. I need forgiveness. And when you come to that point, I realize, God, you're holy and I'm unholy. I need your forgiveness, your grace and mercy. That's when Jesus applies his sacrifice. God poured his judgment on our sin, on his own son on that cross. And that is when applied to us the moment we ask by faith, trusting that is God's provision for our forgiveness. And then he placed part of himself in this most remarkable way, his Holy Spirit within us, the law within us, so that now we have a desire to relate to God, not as a creature relates to a creator. But again, remember 2 Corinthians 6, when he says that, chapter 9, when he says that God wants us to realize, I'll be a father to you and you'll be sons and daughters to me. That's the relationship of the new covenant. Well, the key to understand this and bringing these new believers to understand the new covenant is the fact that you don't need to have a priest that you take a sacrifice to. We have a new high priest. And our high priest is the preeminent high priest. It's Jesus Christ. Again, like Paul said, one intercessor between God and man. And tomorrow, we're going to see in chapter 3 what the high priest provided for us so that we could all be, as Peter said, a nation of priests. But how he's doing this is showing that our high priest, Jesus Christ, is superior to any past high priest of an old covenant because, first of all, he's God. He's God the Son. He's divine. And that's what we saw yesterday in chapter 1. Here in chapter 2, he says, and he's unique because he's God who became flesh. And he became flesh for a very, very serious, special reason. And that's what he's going to explain here in chapter 2. That God, the Son, became a man so he could be a total high priest and be able to understand what's it like to represent us. So he knows what it's like to represent God as a priest because he's God, chapter 1. But now, how would he be our high priest and represent us, our feelings, our weaknesses to God, unless he became a man? And that's what chapter 2 is about. So let's pick it up. Verse 1. The writer says, for this reason, we must pay much closer attention to what we have heard, lest we drift away from it. For if the word spoken through angels proved to be unalterable, even transgression and disobedience received a just recompense, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? He's basically warning these folks, you need to listen. Because if God has provided this deliverance, this new covenant, don't be walking away from it. Don't hold on to the old covenant and sacrifice and refuse to move on to the new covenant. That's what the children of Israel did. Remember, God frees them through Moses out of slavery in Egypt. And he takes them to Mount Sinai. And remember, there is where he received the law, the Ten Commandments, the law of God. And then from there, the promise of the land, that was only 11 days. From Mount Sinai to go into the promised land, 11 days. So they show up in Kadesh Barnea, and they send out the 12 spies. Remember, 10 of them come back and go, wow, they're too big. We're like grasshoppers. We can't trust God in this. And then they all turn around. They ignore, basically, the two said, hey, God's going to give it to us. He promised. But they say, we need to go back to Egypt. And that's why, because of their unbelief and refusing to enter into the promise, the covenant of God, God says, fine, that 11 days is going to take 40 years. And remember, that's when the children of Israel walked around for 40 years. And why? So that whole unbelieving generation would die. It would be their children that would enter into the promised land. And that's the book of Joshua, right after the book of Exodus and Numbers. So, boom, you go right into there. Well, that's the same thing he's concerned here. Don't be like your forefathers because of unbelief, refuse to go into the first covenant. Don't, because of unbelief, refuse to embrace and go into this new covenant. So he says in verse 5, for he did not subject to angels the world to come concerning which we are speaking, but one has testified somewhere saying, what is man that thou will rememberest him? Or the son of man that thou art concerned about him? Thou hast made him for a little while lower than the angels. Thou hast crowned him with glory and honor and hast appointed him over the works of thy hands. He's talking about, why does God even care about human beings? So God creates it. He breathes spirit within them. They become a living nephesh, a living spirit. We've talked about that. And so the question here is, God gives, creates heavens and the earth, and he doesn't give it to the angels to rule over it. He gives it to mankind, male and female, to rule over it. So he's like exalting his hopes and dream for mankind. But then notice verse 9. But we do see him who has been made for a little while lower than the angels, namely Jesus. In other words, Jesus had to become a man. He had to be able to become a man so that he could relate and therefore represent man to his heavenly Father and thus complete the fullness of a high priest. Remember, a high priest represented God to the people and then represented the people to God. Well, again, chapter 1, he knows how to represent God to the people because he is God. But here he is, he was made a little lower than the angels, became a human being. like the rest of us. He says, because of the suffering of death. So became a human being and has something to do so that he could suffer and die. Crowned with glory and honor, that would be his resurrection. You got to die before you're raised from the dead. All by the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone. Now, what is this all about? He says, for it was fitting for him, for whom are all things and through whom are all things, in bringing many sons of glory to perfect the author of their salvation through suffering. So here it is, Jesus, God the Son, and all things were created by him. Matter of fact, remember in Colossians chapter 1, verse 16 and 17, Paul said that the Son created all things. He created all things visible, invisible. They were created by him and for him. So he's referring back to this. So he comes, and yet he wants to have many sons that will be ruling this new heaven, new earth with him in glory. So he brings salvation to them. He's going to deliver them. He's going to deliver them to this whole new covenant, new relationship with God, new destiny, new promise, eternal life. But it's going to happen through suffering. Verse 11, for both he who sanctifies, that means makes holy, sets apart, and those who are sanctified are all from one Father, for which reason he is not ashamed to call them brethren. It's interesting. Romans chapter 8, it says that we're joint heirs with Christ. In verse 26, 27, 28, it says that Jesus is the firstborn among many brethren. See, we relate to Jesus, again, as one relates to a high priest, also one relates to our Lord. Jesus is our Savior. But there's one other relationship he's talking about here. If Jesus is the firstborn and he wants to bring many other brethren into relationship with himself, that relationship would be as brothers and sisters, and he would be the older brother. You see, why do we follow Jesus Christ? We're disciples of Jesus Christ. We're not disciples of God the Father. We're not disciples of the Holy Spirit. We're disciples of Jesus Christ because we want to become like Jesus Christ. Why? Because he's the only one who ever heard from heaven twice the Father say, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." He said it at his baptism, and then he said it in Matthew 17 at his transfiguration. This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. Well, when we became followers of Christ, we become children of God. Remember John chapter 1, verse 11 and 12. But as many as believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, to them God gave the authority to become the children of God. That's why, again, in 2 Corinthians 6, he says, and I'll be a father to you, and you'll be sons and daughters to me. So the point being is that we relate to God as our Father. Jesus is the firstborn, our older brother. And the more we learn to be like him, maybe one day we'll also hear, this is my beloved Son, this is my beloved daughter, whom I'm well pleased. And so he provided this deliverance into this new covenant. He made it possible for us to become children of God, not mere creatures. So he says in verse 11, for both he who sanctifies and those who are sanctified are all from one Father. So he's not ashamed to call us brethren. So he says in verse 12, I will proclaim thy name to my brethren. In the midst of the congregation, I will sing thy praise. And again, I'll put my trust in him. And again, behold, I am the children whom God has given me. Now listen to the next two verses, because this is why God the Son took on human flesh, and it has something to do with suffering, and the suffering has something to do with you and I being able to become sons and daughters with the Heavenly Father, who's engaged with every detail of our life. Verse 14 says, then the children share in flesh and blood, that's you and me. He, the Son, himself, likewise also partook of the same, that through death he might render powerless him who had the power of death, that is, the devil, and might deliver those who, through fear of death, that's us, were subject to slavery all their lives. What slavery? Oh, man, I gotta be good. I've got to keep rules, regulations. I gotta embrace the old covenant because I'm so fearful I'm not going to go to heaven. And so because I'm going to die, and again, Hebrews 10:27 says it's appointed unto man once to die and after that judgment. So people are afraid of judgment. They're afraid of death. Next time you're having a party with somebody, just talk to them and say, hey, let's talk about death and just see what direction and how far south that goes. So out of this fear of death, why do we fear death? Because we fear judgment. But what if he already took the judgment for our sin on himself at the cross? But he can only do that if he can suffer and bleed and die. And that's why he took on flesh. Again, that's why John 1, the Gospel of John, when he said in the very first verse, in the beginning was the Word. Word was with God. Word was God. And all things came to being through him. But verse 14 says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Had to become flesh. Had to become a man. Why? Because we are flesh and blood, and we suffer, and we die, and we are sinners. He became not a sinner, but he became flesh and blood. And he who knew no sin became sin for us, so that he could receive our judgment upon himself on that old rugged cross. So he says in verse 16, he brings it to an end. For assuredly he does not give help to angels, for he gives help to the descendants of Abraham. Talking about these Jewish believers. Therefore, he had to be made like his brethren, like us, in all things that he might become, here it is, a merciful and faithful high priest. In things pertaining to God, to make propitiation, the payment, satisfaction, for the sins of the people. For since he himself was tempted in that which he has suffered, he is able to come to the aid of those who are tempted. So we see in chapter 1, he's the high priest because he's God, so he can represent God to us. And so there's no deception. We can walk in the light. We know everything God desires for us because he's our heavenly Father, and our high priest who reveals them to us is his Son. But chapter 2, he's our high priest because he can represent us to the Father because he became one of us. And because he came one of us, he bled and died and thus provided for the forgiveness of our sin by taking the judgment of our sin upon himself. And thus he's the perfect high priest. Boy, tomorrow in chapter 3, you'll see what he does with it. God bless you, and we'll see you tomorrow.